Good evening, everyone. Sorry for the late start. We opened earlier an executive session to discuss litigation and collective bargaining update by the town manager. It just took a little longer than we had expected. I'd like to start today's meeting with the Pledge of Allegiance.
To the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, so we'd like to start off with public forum. Residents are invited to share ideas, opinions, or ask questions regarding the town government. Is there anybody? Okay. Chairman of the Planning Board, please come on up.
Members of the Board of Selectmen, it's been about 10 years since the town started making key decisions on legacy farms. In the early days of the Board of Selectmen, Board of Selectmen made a lot of those key decisions, particularly in the host community agreement, and then also through the last 10 years with updates, et cetera. We are about to do a important milestone with the Legacy Farms, with the road opening of the Legacy North Road on April 6th at 9:30 a.m. I know you all have been invited to the ribbon cutting and to participate in the ribbon cutting, and we've invited all the selectmen for the last 10 years, as well as planning board members for the last 10 years, and actually we're trying to reach out to all members that basically had a hearing or a meeting with the Legacy Farms people, which is almost every town committee for the last 10 years at some time or another. So basically, we'd like to invite everyone to the ribbon cutting on April 6th, 9:30 a.m. It's going to be at Franklin Road in Legacy North. You can park in the commercial parking area, for commercial part of Western Nurseries, right across the street from that. There'll be light refreshments, reception following it at the greenhouse at Western Nurseries. The greenhouse will also be our place if it's really bad weather. We're hoping for good weather on the 6th. So everyone, please bring a pair of scissors, because we'd like you all to help cut the ribbon on this key milestone for Legacy North.
Thank you very much. Anybody else have anything for open session? Wow, this is great. I actually have another little message to bring everyone. I deemed it necessary for the board to review the request from the 26.2 Foundation, dated March 20, 2017, to name Catherine Switzer an honorary Hopkinton citizen. On March 24, 2017, even though this matter was not posted, this would not constitute a violation of the open meeting law because I could not have reasonably anticipated the need for this discussion more than 48 hours prior to the meeting. So we are going to slip something in. Hopefully it won't delay anything. Okay, let's move on to the consent agenda. Brendan, want to read the consent agenda?
Oh, this, yeah.
Just wait, okay. Yeah, go through them if you want to.
The consent agenda, number one, to consider, the Board of Selectmen consider approving the following public session minutes of 2/28/17. Number two, parade permits. The Board of Selectmen will consider approving a parade permit from Kristen Benito of Girls on the Run Greater Boston Empowerment Program for a 5K run on Saturday, June 3, 2017 at 9 o'clock a.m., rain date Sunday, June 4, 2017. The route will begin and end at the Hopkinton High School. Three, special temporary liquor license. The Board of Selectmen will consider approving a special temporary alcohol license from Liz Burke of St. John's the Evangelist Youth Group for a youth group fundraiser spaghetti supper to be held on Saturday, April 8th from 6 to 11 p.m. at St. John's Church. Applicant is requesting a refund of the $75 application fee, as St. John's is a nonprofit tax-exempt organization. Item 4, board appointments. The Board of Selectmen will consider making the following appointments. A, Walter Garland as an associate member of the Board of Appeals to a term expiring June 30, 2018. The Board of Selectmen will consider the following reappointments. B, reappointment of Marilyn Palmer to the Hopkinton Housing Authority as a governor's appointee for a three-year term to expire June 30, 2019, pursuant to Mass General Law Chapter 1218, subsection 5. The Board of Selectmen may appoint the DHCD position by majority vote if the position has been vacant for more than 120 days. And C, reappointment of David Godfrey and Daniel McIntyre to the Permanent Building Committee for a term expiring June 30, 2018. Item 5, a proclamation. The Board of Selectmen will consider approving the proclamations for Eagle Scouts Austin Odell, Tristan Clark, and Andrew Palico of Boy Scout Troop 4, Hopkinton. Scoutmaster for Troop 4 is Edwin Clark, and Richard Odell is the Assistant Scoutmaster. And 6, gifts to the town. In accordance with Hopkinton Marathon policy adopted by the Board January 17, 2012, reimbursement for expenses incurred by the town in connection with the marathon are considered a requirement of the insurance of the parade permit. The Board will consider accepting a gift from the BAA in support of its effort in the amount of $118,000 to the town, along with a gift to the schools in the amount of $25,000 per the agreement between Hopkinton Public Schools and the 26.2 Foundation.
Way to go. Okay, the only one, the number 5, the proclamation. Due to illness and extenuating circumstances, the Eagle Scouts will not be here this evening. We're rescheduling them for, I believe, April 7th. Yes. Is there any one that anybody wants to pull out for further discussion?
Are we still voting on the proclamations for the Eagle Scouts?
Or no, just we're putting it off till.
So we're not even going to vote.
We're not going to vote on it.
Okay, misunderstood.
Yes. I'd like to pull out Section 4, B and C.
Well, we'll just pull out Section 4.
Why don't we do that?
Okay. I have a very small correction to the minutes.
Okay.
Go for it.
Go for it.
Just really quick, on page 4, the vote under annual town election ballot questions, the vote on item 4 is recorded as yes 1 and no 0. It's yes 1 and no 4. There were 4 no votes there.
Okay.
That's it.
That would have
been right. Okay, anything else? I'd like to pull out number 6. Okay, so the chair will seek a motion to approve.
Mr. Chair, yes. I move that we vote to approve the consent agenda items 1 as updated by Ms. Wright. Item 2, item 3, that's it.
Oh, we have a question.
If I may.
You may.
If I may.
Well, I just want
to. Yes, Quincy. Yes, sorry.
Friendly amendment. The vote will indicate that the board is also approving the request to waive the $75 application fee.
Yes. Chair, you have a.
Okay. Oh, yes. Deb.
I just wanted to point out on the consent agenda item 2, the Girls on the Run 5K does not have a rain date. The event will be held on June 3rd, rain or shine.
Yeah. Oh, great. Thank you. Yeah, because it's actually just down there. Okay, great. Yeah.
That's good. Tough it out.
Yeah, exactly.
Excellent. Okay. Any further discussion? Oh, do we have a second?
Second.
Okay, any further discussion on the consent agenda? Hearing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Abstained? Motion carries. Okay, so you wanted to pull out number 4, Mr. Tedstone.
Yes. So, although I don't know Walter Garland, I do know Marilyn Palmer and Daniel McIntyre, and I will tell you that both of these people have worked selflessly for the town for years and years and years, and it's great to see these guys on here, and it's an honor to be able to help them stay on and work for the town. So I wholeheartedly back, with no reservation, back Mrs. Palmer and Mr. McIntyre.
Excellent. I just think it's great that people want to keep coming back and doing it again and again, because experience matters, well, and especially in all of these positions. And to have people that want to come back time and again is just wonderful.
Without us having to beg
for someone else.
Without us, exactly.
Mrs. Palmer exactly. is so qualified. She's yes. so hard.
In regards to this item for the point A,
name, please, name and address.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So I am here.
Oh, okay, good. Come on up. Oh, my goodness. Hey, come on up.
Have a seat.
Have a seat. Introduce yourself.
Sure. As I say, I am Walter Garland. I've been a resident of Hopkinton since 1998, and have been busy in my corporate career for 43 years, just retiring from IBM at the mid-2015, and just finished building a house, actually on two houses in Hopkinton right now. So we just finished building a home over on the lake, and the last 5 years of the experience of that, going before the Conservation Commission, the Board of Appeals, the Planning Board, it gave me a real interest in contributing back to my community. And having moved three times with IBM and landing here in 1998 and staying here since then, my wife and I love this area. And intend to spend the rest of our lives here. And so, having left the corporate world, I thought it was time to give back. So that's why I wanted to apply for this position and help serve my community, make it a better place to live.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Thanks for stepping forward. Mm-hmm. And thank you for putting your hand up.
Well, he said so, he didn't know me.
So. Yeah,
now I know you.
You came with good recommendations.
All right, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Okay, so the chair will entertain a motion to approve the appointments of Walter Garland, Marilyn Palmer, David Godfrey, and Daniel McIntyre to their respective positions.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Abstained? Motion carries. Okay, number five, number six, I was one that pulled that one out because I just wanted everybody to understand that we have this agreement every single year with the BAA, and the gift of $118,000 to the town goes to a lot of great projects, as well as paying for the some of the issues we have with the marathon. And the gift of $25,000 between the Hopkinton Public Schools and the 26.2 Foundation, working with the BAA, goes for anything that the schools want to use it for. And it's very important, especially in this tight fiscal times, running up against some tough budgets. So I just wanted to just point that one out. Really nothing else to say about it. But so chair will entertain a motion. Oh, sure.
Mr. Camallo, the 118. Is that inclusive of the reimbursement for expenses?
Yes.
And first of all, does it cover our expenses?
In the past, yes, it has covered our expenses.
So is this for this year or is it trailing year?
This is for this year.
Okay. And typically, what were our expenses last year, roughly?
They usually, I think, in the 90s range, 80s to 90s, and then the remainder goes to the marathon fund.
And what's this number been over the last couple of years, the gift amount?
118.
So it hasn't changed at all?
Yeah, it has not changed the last 3 years. This will be the third year, I believe.
Okay. Do we know, has it changed for any other towns along the route?
I don't know.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, we generally have somewhere between about $25,000 in the marathon fund every year, so it's pretty close. Okay, so Chair will, any further discussion? Chair will again entertain a motion to approve the, accept the gifts to the town of $118,025.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? Okay. Actually, what I'd like to now squeeze in, just before we get into the Veterans District Agreement, is the 26.2 Foundation. I don't have the paperwork here. Do you want to get that one done, or do you want to wait for that towards the end?
Norman? Yeah, you don't think that can wait till the end of the meeting?
Okay.
No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding.
Yeah, will you take it? Yeah. Exactly. Come on up.
He loves the microphone.
This is the 50th anniversary of Catherine Switzer's historic Boston Marathon run. You remember last year, Roberta Gibb was recognized. She was the first woman to run the Boston Marathon. Catherine Switzer is the first woman to run with an official bib. Last year, the BAA started that particular year out as the year to honor women's running, and it'll end this year with Catherine's run. She in fact will be running this year. In addition, Catherine has started a foundation called the 261 Fearless Foundation. This is a foundation that will encourage running, particularly focused on women and young women in particular. It's global in nature. In fact, Friday she'll be in Hopkinton doing some sort of broadcast from the Common to people in Berlin, Germany, and she will be announcing the establishment of running clubs in Europe from our Common. The Board of Selectmen have in the past made this particular distinction, or have named several marathoners and given them this honor as an honorary citizen. It includes Team Hoyt and Meb Gofleski, who, as you all know, was the 2014 Boston Marathon champion.
Excellent. Thank you very much. It's important. Okay, can I ask the town clerk, is this okay with the town clerk to make an honorary citizen?
I would say it's absolutely perfect to welcome them.
Wonderful.
Citizen.
Excellent. Any words of from the board?
No. If it's good enough for Mr. Kilduff,
I just think Mr. Kilduff, thank you. Thank you for just keeping Hopkinton in the news when it comes to the marathon. The 26.2 Foundation really does a great job of bringing us to light more than just the one day, and I really appreciate it.
Thank you, and you're welcome.
Okay, so the chair will entertain a motion to name and proclaim Catherine Switzer an honorary Hopkinton citizen.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Just aye. Aye.
Oh, so you're
just for the record, the motion will reflect that that's for the day on March 24th, 2017.
Okay. Thank you. All right. So let's take another vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, abstained, motion carries. Okay, now let's get back to our agenda. The Veterans District Agreement. In accordance with agreement by and between the towns of Ashland, Holliston, Hopkinton, and Medway, the Board of Selectmen will consider reauthorizing the town of Hopkinton as a member of the Metro West Veterans District and to designate the town manager to serve as the town of Hopkinton's representative for the district board of directors. Mr. Kamala, can you give us some background on this?
Yes. The regional Metro West Veterans District was established through a vote of four towns, Ashland, Holliston, Hopkinton, and Medway, with the understanding that every year we will come back to each individual town and seek a specific vote from the selectmen to continue or not to continue the district. As part of that approval by the state, we are also subject to review by the state every 2 years for certification. We have successfully gone through that process in past years. I can say that in terms of where we are now, we have a stable district. Although we are losing the director, we recently concluded our interview process and are hoping to name the replacement to John Givner as early as next week. I included in your packet some of the statistics that highlight the work that is done by the district, and at this point we'll take any questions from the board.
Any questions for Mr. Kamala?
I don't have any.
What I just like seeing the Chapter 115 monies and the financial assistance, food, shelter, fuel, and everything else that the veterans get through this. It's something that veterans, we owe them a great debt, and to see that that we're banding together as a group of towns, I'm glad that this goes through quickly every year. So if there's anything else?
I just had one question. As I looked it over, I didn't completely understand the financing on this because I know there's some reimbursement and all. Mr. Kamala, showed the five different towns, at least in the last year, we were in the red by about $11,000, I think. Is that money that we need to budget, or that's money to be reimbursed, or it always catches my eye when we're behind something? What does that mean?
Yes, it's money that we need to budget annually, and then we receive a state reimbursement in the form of the general aid that the town receives.
So we can anticipate that we'll get that $11,000 back. It's not that we came in short, we under budgeted, and we're actually short. That will come back to us.
That is correct.
Okay.
And in fact, what we do is we go to the Appropriations Committee, request a reserve fund transfers to make sure that the payments to the veterans are timely.
Right.
And thereafter, we receive reimbursement from the state.
Don't like to see red. Just worried. Thank you.
Okay. So. Chair, I entertain a motion that we move in accordance with the agreement by and among the towns of Ashland, Holliston, Hopkinton, and Medway for the Veterans District dated November 10, 2011. The town of Hopkinton continues its membership with the Metro West Veterans Services District, and that the board designate town manager Norman Kamala as the town's representative on the district board of directors.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed, abstained? Mr. Kamala, it passes. Okay, next up, the Center Reuse Advisory Team Charge. The Board of Selectmen will consider approving a charge for the Center School Reuse Advisory Team, which will study and make recommendations on the future use of the Center School buildings and grounds. Get my paperwork on this one. So, Mr. Kamala, would you want to introduce this one, or is this
Lazarus? Through the chair, following votes by both the selectmen as well as the school committee, town staff was authorized to look into drafting a charge for the center school reuse. You will recall that the pursuit of this request is also a partial response to the MSBA funding that was granted for the elementary school project. And in our preliminary discussions with the Board of Selectmen, we understood the charge to entail, I think, the following key elements. One, the board was looking for an advisory team to look into the issue. Number two, the board was interested specifically in outside expertise. In other words, finding a team that is semi-professional, that will give the best outside advice to the board. We were also tasked with identifying a mechanism that will allow some key boards in town to be part of this process, including the Board of Selectmen, the School Committee, Park and Rec, as well as the Historic District Commission. And so you'll notice that the charge that is proffered today does incorporate a mechanism that will allow for the participation of these key boards in town. Finally, we were also looking at the option of identifying a process as part of the charge that will allow for greater participation and input from the wider community. And at this point, with the chair's permission, I want to thank Elaine Lazarus for doing the heavy lifting in drafting this charge, and she will be available to work alongside me to answer any questions that the board may have.
Excellent. Excellent. Ms. Wright.
Well, right off the top, it says four non-voting members. Mr. Kamali, you mentioned Park and Rec. They are not here. That would make five. So that is one question, and I also, because I had thought of Park and Rec as well, and I questioned where the school committee fits in. I thought that the school committee has basically vacated their interest in the center school building, and those boards that should be involved would be those that would have some input into the future use as a non-school. So I thought of Parks and Rec myself. I thought of perhaps a Chamber of Commerce rep. I thought of an at-large member, but I don't quite, A, I don't see where the school committee fits, and B, you did mention Parks and Rec, which would make five unless school committee was substituted for Parks and Rec.
I stand corrected. I know in our preliminary discussions we had mentioned Park and Rec, but by the end of the day we had not included them in the list of committees to participate. The school committee appears because of past experience. When the town or when the Board of Selectmen constituted a similar committee previously, the school committee was represented. Secondly, we have also had sentiments expressed with regard to potential location of other school uses on the property, and I think that's why we included the school committee.
The school committee is in, Parks and Rec is out, and it's still four liaisons. Okay.
Yeah. Todd, anything?
At first I had made the same observation to myself that Ms. Wright was making on the school committee being in this non-voting liaison list. But, you know, again, we come back to that phrase, it's non-voting liaison. Mm-hmm. I don't care if we have a member from every board and committee in town. They can be there. More input is better, and, you know, it allows us to make a better decision or a more informed decision. So I certainly don't have an issue with that. I think that the composition right now, it seems, it does seem ideal, but it also seems very restrictive. We're saying the membership shall be as follows, and then it has a defined background for each of the five voting positions. Based on my experience, we usually have a difficult time finding someone to fit all of the descriptions. So at the very least, I think we should say that, you know, the target membership shall be as follows. You know, that seems minor, but the other thing being, one of the items is a resident with a background in master planning and zoning, and then we've also got a non-voting liaison spot for a member of the planning board. And it seems to me that we'd be able to bring those two together in some way. Maybe having that background in master planning and zoning coming from the non-voting member on the planning board, and then we can open up one spot just for someone with interest in the project without any particular professional expertise or background.
At large.
An at-large member. So that's the biggest thing that I see here.
Brendan.
Good.
Yeah, well, I was just encouraged to see that, you know, we really are looking for some, you know, semi-professionals, and that, you know, to, you know, I don't know if we might be able to find a registered architect, you know, but we, I'm sure we'll be able to find somebody with real estate and property development, you know, somebody from the Chamber of Commerce, you know, land development, public relations. Actually, Todd, you're actually pretty good with the press secretary.
Yeah.
No, because you know, it'll make it a lot more efficient. You know, we can put together boards together with all at large members, but then it may not be as efficient as we're looking to make it, because it's a very important part of the town. It's right on Town Hall. It's a very expensive piece of real estate, and we want to make sure it's used to its fullest extent.
You know, I mean, part of me might even suggest that, you know, we do try to blend those two roles, that voting member that has the background in master planning and zoning, and the planning board member who doesn't have a vote, and maybe if it's not an at-large position that we create as a voting member, then have the historical district commission have a vote. Because that is, you know, right in the middle of our historic district, and you know, it just seems to me that vote should carry some weight.
Well, then, yeah, but then the way I see it, I'm sorry.
Oh, no, go ahead.
You know, but then the way I see it, then the you know, if we can't just have just one committee have a vote, you know, we should really make sure that make it fair. Then the you know, if we're going to make the if we're going to allow the planning board to vote and the historic commission to vote, then, and we were earlier saying that it's great to have as many committees on there as possible. If we could have the Parks and Rec on there, you know, then we might as well make them all voting positions and make it a 9-member board like the planning board.
Mm-hmm.
Because
too many people.
No, well, that's why. So we have to draw the line somewhere. So it's 5 voting members and 4 non, or go the other way, because, you know, when it doesn't seem
well, again, then my vote, I guess, would be to have that last position be at large, and then the planning board can have their non-voting spot and lend their expertise.
Mm-hmm.
If I may, the way I kind of saw the difference between the voting positions and the non-voting positions, the voting positions all seem to be individuals that will bring some kind of a function to the board that is needed. Whether you're real estate property management people, they understand marketing, they understand what the current demand is for what types of use you might want to put in. Your architect brings a design element as this site starts to take shape. Your land development, you bring knowledge about site design. Public relations, you're talking about either selling it to the public, getting public input, you know, advertising. These are all functions to developing a plan that will work and be accepted and will actually be saleable. Whereas these others are all standing committees which might have a say or have some input, but they don't bring the same kind of functionality that those 4 voting members bring. So I kind of see a difference where they could be advisory and give input, but they aren't, as I said, they don't bring the functionality. I did just want to address the question about the Historic District Commission, because I know the chairman took the time to write a letter, and, you know, she's watching home tonight. Historic District Commission is near and dear to my heart. It's the place where I first put my foot into town government 30 years ago, and from there on, and remained there. So I love Historic District, and I understand their interest. But in terms of their needing to be a voting member any more than these other boards, the Historic District, we're talking about an entire site plan and the reuse of the building and the redevelopment of the entire site, potentially. The charge of the Historic District Commission is very narrow. It pertains to the exterior of the original Center School building and any changes made to the exterior that are visible from a public way. That's it. Has nothing to do with what goes on inside. Has nothing to do with what goes on behind the site or the land that's developed. And the setting of the historic building, if there are changes that come to that, that will go before the Historic District Commission, and any planning needs to bear in mind that it's going to have to pass muster if they make changes to the exterior. So the Historic District has its opportunity, and a very powerful opportunity, to weigh in on the exterior changes to the building. That's about it. If that member, so as I said, that's the extent of their involvement with the project. If that member were a voting member, I don't know whether as a liaison, when that application came before the district commission, if they would have the same need of recusal, but certainly if they have been a voting member on the reuse committee, they would have to recuse themselves from a vote on the certificate of appropriateness, which might disadvantage the commission if they have trouble getting a quorum or whatever. So while I support the district commission, I don't see where the function of that commission rises to being a voting member the same way these others have a function in the site development process.
Well, I see it very similarly in that the Board of Selectmen is going to get another bite of the apple. The Planning Board is absolutely going to get another bite of the apple, and so will the Historic District Commission. So it's going to come before all of the full boards, and to have the input, I think that's important. That each of the liaisons are there for some of the deliberations. Are there to put the spice into it. Mm-hmm. They may not be dealing with the whole meat of the project, but to bring some knowledge and because we're talking about the semi-professionals. But people that represent their individual boards do bring things to the table. And I think that as liaisons and as members of the group, that they will have some influence. Anybody else? Anything else? Brendan?
I wanted to ask, why was Parks and Rec removed as a possible member, because I know there's been discussion about using the back gymnasium, there's field space in back.
Office space, and
right now Parks and Rec is up the street. There could be a role for a Parks and Rec function out of that site, or not, but.
Yeah.
I think that's specific to the function, though, to the future use, as opposed to, as you were stating, about the individual members, the voting members. You have
skills,
real estate, skills that you're bringing to the decision.
Yeah.
Certainly I would expect that Parks and Rec, if they have an interest in using that space, then I would hope that they would come to the meetings
But I believe to your previous point, though, to Todd, that if they're not voting and they're not counting towards a quorum, that we probably should add a member of the Parks and Rec if they're willing to go to it.
As a liaison. Position.
We can add whoever we want to as a liaison. If they don't have a vote, they have a voice, but not a vote.
But to add them, if we have this, school committee, the Selectmen, Historic District, and Planning Board, there is a gymnasium attached to that place. Whether or not it stays or not, but that's a very good point.
I thought they were interested in at least the gym, maybe.
If we could add a liaison from Parks and Rec, because it doesn't have to be, it doesn't have to be nine members, if they're not counting towards a quorum.
Again, the thought. Was part of our preliminary thinking. However, as we were developing the charge, it became imperative that we look for independent, objective, semi-professional advice. Mm-hmm. We felt that if Park and Rec were part of the process, people may think that we've predetermined the outcome.
Mm-hmm. It really sets something up for more of a lobbying interest than just giving objective opinion.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, that's not to say that these are all open meetings, that if there were a Parks and Rec consideration, they can't come to the meeting and give their input, and, you know, we can invite, the board can ask them to continue to come to the meetings if they start going down that road.
Yep.
Okay, so...
So, Mr. Chair, I would suggest that that we make the change for the fifth member, and rather than being someone with a background in master planning and zoning, have it be a member of the community at large.
Okay.
I'll make that a motion.
Okay, and if I could add to your motion, on the key references, I'd like to add the visioning, along with the open space recreation plan, the Hopkinton master plan, the feasibility 2010 feasibility study, and also the our visioning statements, because that encompasses a lot of the town's thinking. That was a year's worth of thinking going into that.
Do you need a second on that?
No, I'm just throwing in a... There wasn't a second yet, so I was just seeing if you...
A second.
We took you. Would you accept my friendly amendment?
I would.
Mr. Sestari, thank you. Ms. Wright, anything to add to the draft?
I don't think so.
Okay, so the... yes, Mr. Kamala.
We also, under the charge, wanted to discuss with the board identifying the staff support to this board. If the board is so inclined, you can simply ask the town manager to delegate staff support.
Okay. Is that in here?
Yeah, under charge. So I work with the town manager or his or her designee.
What number is that? Or you want to add that?
It's right there under charge, last page.
Right in there.
Identify staff report. Oh, geez, right at the top. It's in italics, of course. Yeah. I would have missed it.
So town manager or his or her?
Designee.
Designee.
Yes.
His, her, designee. Okay.
Mr. Sestari, would you accept that friendly amendment?
Yep.
Yes.
Ted Stone. Okay. Anything else? Okay. Any further discussion? Not hearing none. How do you vote?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained?
Okay.
Yeah, I didn't say I vote aye.
Yeah, no, you didn't see.
I vote aye, too.
Okay, my goodness. I was you guys falling asleep there. And this is one of our short meetings.
It's confusing to me.
Oh, well, we it was your motion, and all right.
Okay.
Okay, so moving on. Master Plan Implementation Plan Review. Board of Selectmen will review staff suggestions regarding the implementation plan and draft master plan for the purpose of providing recommendations to the planning board. Now, I just want to say the planning board really did a great job on this revision. They went through the entire master plan, and they got input from a lot of committees and town personnel, and it really was a great collaborative effort. The chairman of the planning board's here. Thank you very much. You really did a great job with this. It's a really clean update. If we can get the implementation plan down, I think we're gonna do pretty well. All right. So I've got. I've got my copy here. I have a couple changes on mine.
In fact, as the chair is going through the notes, we can point out that in your packet, staff included both the draft master plan as well as the staff recommendations regarding the implementation plan. This is an issue that we brought before the board. I think this is our second or third time. Our recommendation is that the board accept the recommendations included in your packet offered by staff. If the board has any questions or if the board is so inclined, we can walk you through our recommendations.
Okay. You want to go through the start up from the beginning?
Yes, we can walk you through very quickly.
Okay.
The first one under land use. LU2, complete and present the master plan for the Pratt Irvine Todaro properties to town meeting. Our timeline is that this be completed by 2019 by the selectmen and the town manager and the responsible advisory committees. We may require possible funding for consultants. To date, we have secured grant funding to support the Pratt Farm master planning process. Move up. Sorry, mine jumped. Sorry, Mr. Chair, my mouse acted up.
Okay. Yeah, next one's LU7.
Yeah, next one is LU7, implementing the Main Street corridor improvements. Our timeline is 2021, working with the town manager, the selectmen, and town staff. Additional resources, we were working hard to continue to maintain our TIP funding as well as identifying any other possible funding sources.
How are we looking on that one for the start? Are we still on track?
Yeah, a couple of things, and in fact, Dave just walked in. Number one, we received confirmation, I think 2 weeks ago, that we're still on the TIP list. Mr. Wisemetal, you should know, thanks to your efforts. Number two, we are now in the final stages in our conversations with MassDOT regarding the intersection improvements and the adjustments to the plan that was submitted as the 25% design plan.
Excellent. Okay, hardscape, landscape.
Yeah. Target date 2021, again, implementers, Board of Selectmen and Town Manager. We may require some funding, and if need be, we will work with, as we've done, with the Chamber of Commerce to identify alternative funding sources. LU11, policies, services, settings, structures that support and enable people to age well in the community, ongoing effort, additional resources, it's brain power. Mm-hmm. Next is NCO13, support town boards and committees whose mission is to obtain open space and conservation restrictions for the town. The board will play, I think, three significant roles. One, collaborating with the different entities that are working on the issues. Number two, identifying the administrative mechanisms for bringing suggestions to town meeting. Number three, identifying alternative funding mechanisms beyond taxation.
Yep.
And then H1, use Community Preservation Act funds and Affordable Housing Trust funds to create affordable rental units. Timeline 2025, additional resources at this point, none. Then going down to H9, reconvene the housing committee if the town is in danger of falling below the 10% affordable housing goal at the next federal census. I think what this is acknowledging is that in spite of the town's gallant efforts getting to the greater than 10% of housing being affordable housing, the new census data from the 2020 census may change that playing field.
Where are we at right now? Do you know?
11% is projected for 2020 at this point. Yeah. The planning board is discussing that on Monday, so I just got a new sheet today. So.
Yep, thank you.
And then moving on to economic development. Several items identified. We are recommending that this be considered ongoing. Joint efforts by the town manager and the selectmen, specifically with regard to providing municipal water and sewer services, there may be funding that is required. In the past, we have relied on betterments as well as grant funding. Any questions?
None on that one.
Well, yeah, if we're going to provide water and sewer, the cost would not be on us. It would be on the people that are building the facility, correct?
That is correct.
Yeah.
I should also mention, I think the preface to this whole exercise is the work that we're doing developing a business plan for the two enterprises. There's also the goal number ED7, diversifying the tech space.
What about three?
I grouped three and one together.
Okay.
Yeah.
Moving on.
ED7, diversifying the tech space. This is an ongoing effort. We will work diligently with all the related or the concerned or respective town boards. At this point, we're not identifying any need for funding.
Now, this is a big one for me, ED9.
Yeah, ED9. Again, it needs to be said, the effort that the town is putting under the compact grant funding, I think, lays a good foundation for goal number ED9. There was a great meeting this morning attended, I think, by two of the board members as well as Mr. Wisemantel and representatives from the Chamber of Commerce. Through the efforts of Elaine's office, we have engaged a consultant who is helping us identify our business strengths and opportunities. And we're going to use that to identify ways of strengthening the town's work regarding economic development and leverage our partnership with the Chamber of Commerce to move forward some of the goals that will be identified through this process.
Yes, because we absolutely need somebody that is looking out for the town. That's some of the things that, with the rapidly changing landscape on South Street Main Street and other properties around town, we've got to make sure that we have somebody that out there looking for the right businesses and put them in the right places. That was something that came up with some of the other businesses that came into the downtown earlier. They were saying, well, didn't we have anybody out there looking out for the town? I think it's very important to continue working with the Chamber of Commerce, have more of those meetings like there were this morning, and so we can identify issues ahead of time and act upon them, but to really move up that timeline from 2022 and to make sure that we have somebody in place that can help market our town, sell our town, and make sure that we have so it brings us back to the ED7 so that we can try and diversify that tax base or at least keep it where it is, depending on what happens with some of these, with the shifting sands with the businesses.
Yeah. And then shifting on to community facilities and services, This is a much longer list.
Wait, we skipped ED10.
Sorry, ED10, sorry.
Yeah, that's another one that's near and dear to my heart.
Exactly.
Yes, it certainly is.
Yes, create sufficient parking in the downtown to meet demand. I think this is an ongoing effort, partnership between the selectmen, town manager, as well as the planning board. We are continuing to find solutions to our parking needs.
Excellent. Yeah, so we just and that's why I think that ED9 could also help out ED10 as well as ED7.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, community facilities and services. Much longer list. Focus is on water, sewer, roads, solid waste disposal, schools, and other facilities that, as a result of the growth of the town, need to be expanded. This is going to be an ongoing effort, collaboration between the town manager, board of selectmen, and other respective town boards, and funding will be identified as the planning process progresses. The next four focus on, in fact, the next five focus on the work that needs to be done with respect to water supply and sewer services, including updating the CWMP. Our goal for that specific project is to complete that by 2020, and we may need consulting services to move the project forward.
Okay.
CFS 8, I think that's a very interesting suggestion from the planning board, that the town encourages the implementation with input from the Board of Health of state-of-the-art sewer solutions or alternative systems using the CWMP as a guide. Our goal for completing this is 2025. Going down the list, I'm going to jump on to CFS 13. That's a PI effort. I think consider that is education, providing parking and signage where public hiking trails exist or are being developed. I think this builds on the assets that the town has built over the years with regard to recreational trails. And also ensuring that the Department of Public Works can maintain existing roads, bridges through an adequately funded maintenance program. I think what the town has done over the years is to continue to rely on Chapter 90 as well as direct appropriation at town meeting to fund the pavement management program. We hope to continue that process. And then there's also CFS 16, the board just discussed that. It's developing the reuse plan for the center school building and grounds, which considers anticipated municipal needs based on changing population. CFS 17, this is a charge that should be passed on to the Permanent Building Committee, updating and implementing the capital asset management plan. We also, I think, as we have learned over the last 2 years, that we need to integrate or include the finance director in the process. Mm-hmm. Elaine, is there anything else that needs to be emphasized under community facilities that we haven't touched on?
The next four.
Okay, the next four, five, the CFS 18 through 23. Support the efforts to create bicycle and pedestrian trail development, coordinating trail development and maintenance by vesting such planning and activity in one particular board, committee, or staff person. And to that point, I think there have been preliminary discussions within the community as to how that could move forward, with the realization that there are different trail groups doing excellent work. We also have the Upper Charles Trails Committee that is focusing on the center trail. And also over the years, we're realizing that as more trail assets come under the town, there's need for maintenance and management. And so the suggestion is that perhaps the town looks into identifying one committee that will focus specifically on the maintenance of the trails.
That was CFS 21. You went from 17 to 23, but I think 21 is very important.
Okay, yeah, 21 is also identifying the need for future fire department. We have had preliminary conversations with the fire chief in terms of how we can get to that goal. Through the work that we did with the town of Ashland, we collected some background data that will be useful in that regard. And then also CFS 22, I think also thanks to the wisdom of prior town boards, the town did identify through the host community agreements some mechanism for identifying, monitoring, and planning for the potential impact of increased school enrollments across the district. Mm-hmm. And then 23 focuses on energy efficiency and sustainability, and improving public health and community resilience. Ongoing effort requires coordination by the town manager and the selectmen with respective boards in town. At this point, we are not identifying any need for funding or additional resources. Any questions?
Not so far, but now, you're going to get into transportation next?
Yeah, transportation. And I'm sure this responsibility was assigned to the selectmen as the road commissioners. Mm-hmm. Improve the operational capacity and safety at the following key intersections: 85 and Route 135, Lumber Street, West Main Street, Wood Street, West Main Street, Main Street, Pleasant Street, Main Street, Chestnut Street, Hayden Row, Main Street, and Mizev Street.
But I'd also, if it's possible, I don't know if to amend this and add the Hayden Row and Grove Street, because we've had a couple the whole school section, that's where we've had several meetings on, not just
Chestnut Street and Hayden Row.
Yeah.
Okay. But that's just the traffic signal, but there were a lot of other safety improvements.
Something else.
Yeah, T4, I think, covers the whole corridor.
Okay, thank you. I just wanted to make sure that was included, because that one's hot right now. That's one of those that, it should have like a 2017 on there.
Just going through the list. I like T5, and I'm sure the planning board is highlighting transportation demand management in reviewing some of the larger scale projects that come through the board's review process. Anything else, Elaine, that needs to be highlighted under transportation?
T11?
Yeah, T11. Mm. Provide all-day parking and or shuttle service for carpool, bus, and rail commuters. Consider Hopkinton State Park as one such facility.
That's great. That's good forward thinking.
Mm-hmm.
Excellent.
Yeah. And at this point, any questions from the board?
I did have a question on one of the items that's not under Board of Selectmen Town Manager, which is, I know, our primary focus, but seeing as this is supposed to be the last stop for the whole thing, when that's appropriate, I'd like to
go on.
Comment. Okay. Going back, way back to the natural cultural resources, NCOs, they're at the very beginning. I'm wearing the hat that I was used to, which was looking out for historic resources. And this is something that I did mention to the planning board, or the planning office, that, over the years, the town, at the urging of the Historical Commission, we've enacted a number of changes and additions to our subdivision rules so that as land comes in for development, if there are significant historic resources, the developer is A, alerted that we value those and please try to spare them, and B, options for them to, whether it's putting them in the open space so that they're saved or carving out a special lot to preserve a historic home. We have built in options for developers to accommodate that. But a big part of that, when a piece of land comes up to development, the planning board is where this goes. The Historical Commission has no knowledge of these things coming up. And so both NCO 2, which talks about increasing awareness of advantage of preservation in the early stages of land planning development review, the planning board, if they want to put historical commission as well, that's fine, but the planning board is the stop where that would happen. And the same thing with implementing town bylaws. Historical commission may work to develop new bylaws that would encourage, but in terms of bringing existing tools to a developer's attention, the historical commission never sees these plans. And the whole idea is that you do this before the train has left the station. There was an email we just received. It's a little premature about the possibility of the Wayland Road, Chamberlain Street development that pointed out that there is a cellar hole in there that dates back, that has a connection to the Salem witch trials.
I read that.
I had no idea. That's the kind of thing that as that moves along, a planning board needs to be alert to say, put that in the open space, or work around it, keep it within the public way, or, you know, save this. So I respectfully request that this kind of direction for developers to preserve historic resources needs to be first and foremost encouraged through the planning board as when the land comes up for development. Mr. Wisemantle, I don't know how you feel about that, but I've been there. I was always the one on that board that spoke up for those things, but I'm not there now. So I want to make sure that it's on their radar to help out developers.
Mr. Chairman.
To answer your question, Claire, I think we've changed.
Name and address, please.
The planning board recently changed our regulations to have the historic commission, I believe, get copies of plans and stuff so that they are now aware at the front of the part. And even with your absence on the board, cellar holes, et cetera, is something that the planning board members are still interested in. As we're planning for these upcoming hearings, you can be rest assured that one will be on the agenda.
Well, I respectfully appreciate that it's being sent to the Historical Commission. They asked a long time ago that they be in the loop, but there's no guarantee that they see everything or that someone will come. The idea of implementation is which is the board that's going to have an opportunity to make these priorities that we've set out as a town actually happen. And we have said that we value not only our natural resources, but our historic resources. And so it's called right out in the priorities of the subdivision regulations. And I would like it to also be called out. The planning board needs to make developers aware of what's on the property and what's, you know, I don't want to hear that something valuable got lost because a historical commission person didn't come to the meeting that night when it was right in front of the board and it's called out in the subdivision regulations that this is something the town values and there are tools in place to help a developer save it. I'm just asking that the first stop, which is the planning board, early stages of land development, be the ones to advocate.
First of all, I assure you that the planning board follows our own regulations. We probably do it religiously, as you know. So the fact that it is in the regulations and it is of interest, that's something we would look at.
If I may, Mr. Chairman, NCO 5, though, implement town bylaws that encourage, require, reward the preservation of historic resources. That really That would have to come from the planning
board.
Well,
a lot of times on things like that, we rely on the, I'll say the historic commission or somebody else who has the focus on it to bring that attention of things that they want to change to Zach.
That would be suggested then, as opposed to
develop. But implement means make it happen.
Right. So we have to either change that word.
Put it into practice. It's on the books. Okay. Now see that it happens.
We'll take a look at those ones.
Because that would be Zach and planning board if it was implementation.
I mean, I can give an example of the town owns a property now on Lumber Street because it was not a demolition, and so there was nothing that flagged the historical commission that there was a house of significant historical value to the town until not only had the train left the station, it was chugging way down the track, and it was way too late to do anything to save this property within the development. And that wouldn't have happened if we had had the things that we do have in place now. And the planning board could have said to that developer up front, look, you've got this property, this is what you can do. Town prioritizes our historic resources. I'm just looking at where the first stop is, and that's where it becomes painful for a developer if they're halfway into their plans, and then another board comes in and says, stop, 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 we want you to change. It needs to happen in the early stages. And I just...
The planning board does support the historic commission on their parts, but quite frankly, they are their charter is solely to be the guardian of historic structures in the community. And they have to take, I'm going to say, the lion's share of the responsibility, because that's their charter. Otherwise, why have a historic commission, quite frankly?
But we have stated right in our subdivision, in our master plan as to what the town values, and in our subdivision rules and regulations, it talks about preserving natural natural and historic. I really disagree.
Okay, but if you, could you take a look at
it? We will look at what the wording is on those. I believe the Historic Commission has approved taking on those two action items at this point.
Right.
So the commission has taken it.
Anything else on your list?
No, that's it for me.
Brendan?
No, I covered what I was going to say.
Excellent.
In other words, you agree with me?
Yep.
Okay.
Okay.
Two out of four.
Two out of three.
Mr. Kamala, what's the motion on this one?
We request that the board approve the recommendations by staff regarding the master plan implementation plan with the suggested revision that the historical assets be reworded from. I can't remember what the current wording is to implement. Replace develop with implement.
Okay, because right here I have provide recommendations to the planning board.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess we just did that. Chair will entertain a motion to approve Mr. Kamalo's motion.
So moved.
I'm not clear what Mr. Kamalo's motion is.
That the board approve the staff recommendations as contained in the document shared tonight with the board regarding the implementation plan, subject to the revision to NCO2, where the suggestion is that the planning board implement versus simply increasing the awareness.
Okay.
Do you accept the...
I do.
Excellent. Claire, are you going to give a second?
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion? Hearing none, how do you vote? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Motion carries. Okay, next one is a stop sign at Granite Street, Lumber Street intersection. The Board of Selectmen will consider a request to install a stop sign at the Granite Street, Lumber Street intersection. Mr. Kamalo, could you enlighten us on this one?
Yes, John Westerling is here to represent the opinions of the town engineer, the police chief, on the suggested stop sign at Granite Street and Lumber Street.
Good evening. Through you, Mr. Chairman. We received a request last year to improve the safety of the intersection of Granite Street at Lumber Street. And if you can, if we can bring up the map that's shown on the computer here, I can show you exactly where we are. So we are, here's West Main Street, 495. We're over here at Granite and Lumber Street. And as you can see, it is a T intersection, and there are no traffic controls anywhere on either one of these three legs. And we looked at several different options, and what we came up with was the best way to improve the safety of this intersection is with the installation of a stop sign for that traffic that's traveling southwesterly down Granite Street into the intersection. We will also paint a center yellow line for about 100 feet on Lumber and Granite. The best indication of the problem here is this is coming down Granite Street. What we would propose is a stop sign right here. This is for people that are heading in that southwesterly direction. And you can see vehicles that are coming down Lumber Street, when they take that corner on a Granite, they don't respect the fact that there is a corner here and that there may be a car coming up into this intersection. So a stop sign here along with yellow center lines on Lumber and yellow center lines on Granite will keep vehicles in their own lanes and help to avoid the potential for accidents there.
So the issue is you're stopping the cars on Granite Street so that they don't get hit by cars that are coming down Lumber and taking that left, correct?
Correct. It's to prevent cars that are traveling down Granite from taking a left onto Lumber without even stopping to look, or a right onto Lumber without seeing this. This section of this leg of Lumber Street is very narrow. It's barely a car width wide. So it's a very tight intersection, and you can see that there's not very good sight distance here because of the change in grade. Here's that other leg of Lumber Street coming from Milford. So sight distance is compromised on every leg, and just getting vehicles to stop at Granite Street, again, with the addition, similar to what we did over on West Elm Street, where you just paint in the center line, and that helps cars to understand that they need to stay in their own lane.
That's what I was going to ask you, because, you know, coming off of School Street onto West Main, there's a dotted line that keeps people in their respective lanes. I think that's a very important part of the intersection design.
Mr. Westerling, are there... I'm sorry.
No, go ahead, Mr. Tesbury.
Are there other streets in town that intersect that don't have stop signs on them? So isn't it... I mean, I'm all for putting a stop sign there, but I don't know why there isn't already one. With the exception of where Chestnut turns into Ash, you know, Ash Street actually has to stop to enter Ash Street. But are there many other streets in town that when we meet, where one street meets another that's running through, that there's not a stop sign on that?
Offhand, through you, Mr. Chairman, I would say that there probably are. For example, just a year or two ago, we voted, the Board of Selectmen voted to install a stop sign at the end of Hayden Row where it intersects with Main Street. That was a T intersection that had no control. So I'm sure that there are others, and you may see me here before you in the future seeking a similar vote.
The west side of town. There's
I don't
many.
Think there's a reason to have Mr. Westerling come before us.
We have
if there's...
Well, we control the street, so and the purse strings, so we have to make sure that it's approved.
Additionally, Mr. Chairman, as road commissioners, if you don't vote and we just install a stop sign and someone goes through and there's a violation, it's not enforceable by the police department because it wasn't voted to install the sign there.
That's correct.
I retract that last statement. Never happened.
Anything to add, Mr. Kamala?
No.
I just wanted to ask, from that picture that you put up, it looks like you'd be putting the stop sign so far back that the car can't really see around the corner. I guess it would force them to stop and then creep forward.
No, it's
where is it going
to
be?
It's difficult to see here, but we would install it like right here. This is that car that was coming through
right.
the intersection. So we would install it right here. I only was that far back because that's where the Google Maps caught that vehicle
okay.
in the wrong lane. So we'll install
it. If the stop line is so far back that you can't see anything, people just pull forward to where they can see anyway, and then you
I agree.
Still get hit. But
I agree.
No,
well, I do believe that there are standards for where the stop sign should be anyway, a certain distance back from the intersection. Yeah. So it has to stay within that tolerance.
Configuration, right.
Okay. Okay. Anything else for Mr. Westling?
Not for me.
Mr. Kamalo, anything for Mr. Westling?
Nothing to add.
Move to approve.
Excellent. Okay, so motion
Westling,
to...
Westling, would you like any feedback on the new trash barrels that have been put out?
No, let's stick to the... Let's stick to the agenda item.
I don't have it.
Okay, so the chair will entertain a motion to approve a stop sign at the Granite Street-Lumber Street intersection per the discussion earlier.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion of this subject?
No.
All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Motion carries.
Thank you very much.
Okay, board liaison reports and board invites. Mr. Kamalo, do we have any board invites?
Yes, Mr. Chair, specifically, as we heard earlier, there is the invite to the Legacy Farms Road North opening April 6th. And then there is the request from the Metro West Youth Teaming Together Summit Monday, April 24th, beginning at 8 a.m., followed by the invite from the Michael Lisno Respite Center to honor our 2017 marathon team celebrating 20 years, Saturday, April 15th, starting at 3 p.m.
Okay. Any liaison reports, Mr. Goodstone?
Yeah, I went to the Elementary School Building Committee meeting this week. It's very productive. Everything's on schedule. Everything is looking pretty good. They've done a pretty good job of implementing those four new classrooms that we voted on, and everyone's happy with the progress as well as the fiscal responsibility of the program.
Excellent. Ms. Wright?
Not a board liaison, but Mr. Sestari and I both went to the five-town Board of Selectmen's meeting a couple weeks ago, which was very interesting, including Ashland, Holliston, Medway, Hoppington, and Millis, I believe. Everything from marijuana laws to budgeting to affordable housing. So when another one comes up, if anyone has an opportunity to come, it's very interesting to hear what other towns are doing and kind of compare things. And I did want to mention, too, that early March I went to the Mass Municipal Association's legislative breakfast, which they have periodically, where they discuss upcoming legislation and its effect on the towns. And I did get a little more information, which is still forthcoming, on the solar farm tax exemption, because I have been concerned that, you know, were this to happen, towns are having big chunks of land taken off their tax rolls without their approval. And I learned a little more about it. It is relative to a couple of cases, one in Swansea and one, I think, in Westboro, where the solar, what would appear to be, I think, solar residential exemption has been interpreted by courts to apply to solar in general. And so there may be a bill coming up on that. We'll find out more about that to resolve it. But what they told us was to be very careful in whatever we negotiated, that you know, we don't disadvantage ourselves. We're obviously being proactive right now, but would this to be overturned so that it is not tax exempt, we want to make sure there's an escape clause so that we
Excellent.
Can. But the good news was that when they heard that I was representing the town of Hoppington, and I said our assessor is John Neese, they said, "Oh, Mr. Neese is extremely knowledgeable about
these tax exemptions and solar issues, so we're in good hands with Mr. Neese. But those are my updates on the extracurricular activities.
Mr. Tedstone and I actually went to the first five town meeting, and it was you know, we got some great insights at what the other towns were thinking of. Well, I went to the to a Trails meeting, a Trails Collaborative, where we had breakout sessions where all the various clubs and committees all came together to discuss trails and to give input and guidance to the rest of the committees. That was a great meeting. And then on last Thursday, I went to the school committee meeting, and among other things, they voted on, people may have seen it in the newspaper, the new elementary school, the Marathon Elementary School. Did you get one of these?
I have one, yeah.
Excellent. Yeah, I thought that was great that they already had T-shirts made up for it. It was kind of fun to see. So we do get to have some fun as Board of Selectmen members. Town Manager's Report.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. In terms of the FY18 budget process, the Appropriation Committee is meeting with department heads to review the budget. So far, they have met with the Department of Public Works, Finance Department, Town Clerk, Elections, as well as Facilities and Engineering. They will continue their meetings and will soon be announcing the public hearing date for the budget. At this point, the CFO has shared with me that the Appropriations Committee has not yet identified any opportunities for budget adjustments that normally would then be referred to the Selectmen and the Town Manager. So the work continues. Draft annual town meeting warrant. We wanted to give you the heads up that the draft warrant is almost ready for prime time. We will be emailing it to the board tomorrow morning for your preliminary review. Please take a look at the warrant articles, and if there's any article that you absolutely believe should be presented in much more detail to the Selectmen, let us know. We'll invite the proponents to come before the board. Okay. Draft kennel licensing bylaw changes. We did advise the board, I think at its last meeting, that this was an issue that we have identified as part of our continuous improvement program. Recent developments have presented opportunities that we believe should be considered in terms of strengthening and improving the bylaw. And what we shared with you in your packet is a draft. We're looking for your input. And in summary, what does the draft do? What does this draft bylaw do? One, it identifies and defines the key elements in any licensing, kennel licensing process. Number two, it also borrows from the best practices identified by different entities throughout the state that we're now incorporating into the bylaw. Thirdly, we also go into detail in terms of defining the conditions that are expected in the kennels. We attempt to define animal cruelty based on conversations with different entities that work on this issue. We also define the records that we now will be expecting to be kept for kennels. We make a distinction between commercial boarding, training kennel, commercial breeder kennel, domestic charitable corporation kennel, and veterinary kennel licenses. We also go into detail in terms of identifying the key elements of the operations of a kennel. So in a nutshell, that's what this bylaw does. We're putting it in your hands. Take a look at it. If you have any preliminary comments, let us know now. This is going to be an ongoing conversation leading to town meeting.
Okay. Go for us if you have any questions.
Well, yeah, I did. One of the things I had flagged, and you mentioned records, because it refers to records not properly kept, and I thought, well, it should be made clear what records are expected. I didn't see anything in here that addressed records. It just says records not properly kept.
We do, if you give me 1 second.
Because in all fairness, if, you know, records are included, they should be, they should understand what records are expected.
Yeah, I think 6272, it's the...
627.
Yes, 627C, under kennel operations number 2, the name and address of the owner of each dog kept in kennel, other than dogs belonging to the person maintaining the kennel.
Okay.
The staff training that is offered, the contracts that are in place, organizational policies relating to animal care, intake, treatment, adoption, and instances where animals are put to sleep.
So,
inspections.
Through you, Mr. Chair, organizational policies relating to treatment, but not treatment. That does not include veterinary records?
That includes veterinary records.
It does?
Yes.
Well, that's not clear the way it's worded, but okay. I just want to make sure it's clear what the records are. I just had two other thoughts about that. The records...
Mrs. Wright, before you go on, just to answer that point.
Yeah.
We used two phrases, and again, we welcome any advice. We thought that the distinction between animal care and treatment.
Mm-hmm.
Animal care is the general care of the animals, and then treatment is referring to the veterinary records.
Hmm.
But if you believe we need to refine that, we will...
Perhaps you should say veterinary treatment, because treatment could be just, are the dogs treated well or poorly. Treatment's a little broad. Maybe you should just put veterinary.
Subjective as well.
And specify. I wondered about perhaps a requirement that the number of dogs that the kennel is licensed for be posted prominently, just like an occupant. Right there, there's an occupancy permit for a number of people in the room, so that at any time, if an inspection is done by anyone, it's quite easy to see this is the number that's allowed to be had. Require that to be posted on the walls. And I also, in the last section, 62.7D, under the violations, I understand the violation, $50 or $25 per day, but each day such violation continues shall be deemed a separate violation. It just seemed to me that an operator, I can see finding them for what they see right now when they're inspected. Oh, you know, you're over by 3 dogs. But then if they come back and do inspections, it would be so easy to just, you know, move a dog around, put him out in the car in the parking lot until the inspector's gone, then bring him back in. Recidivism, that should there be a structure, whether it's a 3 strikes, you're out thing, whether first you get a warning, second time you get a fine, third time, if you're found in violation, your license is suspended, or something to prevent recidivism. Because, you know, the animal control officer or anyone has better things to do than to be constantly running down. The issue is often when it keeps happening repeatedly. So maybe a sliding scale of at a certain point, the license is revoked if this continues to happen, would be.
Yeah. So in other words, progressive penalties.
Punishment. Yes. Penalties. And after maybe a third offense, the license is suspended or revoked. Because I could certainly see it just being a vicious cycle of going back and going back and going back. That was my only other thing, other than a small typo under item 62.7C, item 6. The very last line says, mailed immediately to the holder. I think it's the holder of the kennel license. So those are my...
Mr. Tedstone.
No, I agree with Mrs. Wright as far as the progressive discipline needs to go. I think that, I'll liken it to the discussions we had with the water and sewer, the people that during a drought water their lawn. The fine is kind of antiquated as far as, you know, a $25 fine is not much, but a $500 fine might be something to keep them more in line. So I'm a firm believer of taking accountability for your actions, and if they, you know, if they're warned once, and they turn their nose to the law, and they get caught a second time, then the penalty should be significant enough to warrant action on the warrant versus writing a check for $25 or $50.
I think with a suspension at a certain point,
yep.
A certain number,
yep.
Third offense.
I'm saying that the fine should be higher than what it is, and then mm-hmm. the supplementary discipline from there.
But then we can't make it. We can't make it so that it puts them out of business either. So it's got to be something. You know, for a second offense, you know, you can maybe double those fines, and maybe a third offense. You know, that's
throwing the number $500 out
okay,
as a round number.
Okay, because we have to be careful.
No, but progressive, and then maybe with a license suspension until there's a hearing or something.
Anything else?
That's all I have.
So mine comes from the other end. Did we seek input from kennel owners or kennel operators to make sure that some of these regulations may not be too onerous? You know, one of the things that you can do is over-regulate, mm-hmm. and we could actually be creating a condition that they may not be able to be opened. I want to make sure that because when we did the daycare, we brought in at Zach, and I believe again at the planning board, we brought in people that actually ran them in other towns to give us some guidance as to how to write these.
We plan to have a conversation with kennel owners. We haven't done that yet.
Okay, that's great, because we could be all well intentioned to make sure that everything's humane and great, but we may be putting so much, maybe regulating so much that the businesses can't even exist in our town, and we want to still make sure that it's fair all around. That's my only input. Okay, so there's no vote on this at this point.
No vote
because
at this point.
If it's still okay, so this is still working. Okay, so then ballot questions. I think you got for us.
Yes. I included in the packet a listing of the ballot questions that the board approved at its meeting February 28, 2017. We have also identified three additional ballot questions. They include the ballot question for the approval of the charter amendments, as was discussed before. Then number two, a ballot question asking if the town shall vote to have its elected constables become appointed constables of the town. This is also consistent with the feedback from the charter process. And then thirdly, is the ballot question regarding the underwrite. We went back to the last Board of Selectmen meeting, and it is our understanding that whereas Mr. Sestari may have mentioned the amount $1.5 million, we were unsure whether that's the amount that the board wanted to set as the underwrite amount. And so we're here tonight to confirm that $1.5 million is the underwrite amount.
Okay. Yeah, I believe that that's, I think he may have just been putting a number out, but what is that? How does that leave us in leeway? What's that leave us in the amount of what percentages that we could go over that 2.5?
I think the amount instead of percentages, in exact dollars, I think the excess levy is approximately 3.2 million. I'll have to check at the budget model.
Okay, so that cuts the excess levy in half.
Yes.
Yeah, I don't know what his goal was to remove it completely, but I don't think that that's fiscally safe thing to do, considering where our town is and looking at 2018 and 2019. But I absolutely believe that we have to reduce it, so that we can't just fool the town and not go when we're actually going over the 2.5. People have to know when we're doing this stuff.
Do we have to decide that tonight? Could that perhaps be put off till next week when Mr. Sestari is here and just get a little more input into his thinking and where it came up with that number?
Yeah, respectfully.
And then we need a full board. There's no way I'm going to do that without the chair here.
Yeah.
I'm just warming up the seat today.
Time crunch.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. We'll table that one then.
So we can deal with this issue?
Yes.
The 28th?
So it looks like seven questions.
Yep. That's it from the town manager.
Excellent. Future board agenda items?
None for me.
Not right now.
I think we hit just about everything. Okay. Excellent. I think that the chair will entertain a motion to adjourn.
Second.
So moved. Second. Whatever.
Okay. Any further discussion? Mr. Kamal, are you all set? Ms. Lazarus? Mm-hmm. All set? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you for your patience for us starting a little bit late, but everybody can get to bed early now. Thank you very much. Have a great night.